Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the fantastic violinist, Margot Schwartz.
Thank you.
concertos together, I think it's beneficial if I speak a few words about what kind of person Beethoven was. Beethoven and his family are unfortunately dead, so we can't verify any of these claims. But it's been known throughout history that Beethoven is someone that's very passionate and quite fearless of a man. He was very passionate about fighting for what he believed was right, and that often made him become at odds with the authorities. But he did not fear the inherited nobility and didn't fear those who had the power. This kind of attitude can be seen if I tell you two anecdotes which I find quite funny. Beethoven, unlike Mozart, rose to fame later during his career, but once he did, he was invited once to a duke's house to teach him piano and to speak. After arriving at the guy's house, Beethoven was told to wait in the lounge area for an indefinite amount of time. So he sat there, and then it ended up being a very ridiculously long amount of time. And then after the lesson finally began and Beethoven entered the room, the Duke played for him, but every mistake the Duke made, Beethoven slapped his hand and his forehead. So the Duke was confused and asked him, "Why are you slapping me? Why are you being so rude?" And Beethoven said, "Because I've wasted so much time in your damn living room that I don't have any more patience." Another story is when he was walking, he loved to take walks, he loved to stroll in nature because he thought it would calm him down and give him inspiration. So he was walking with the famous German poet Goethe. Goethe, like Beethoven, was another person who believed very much in the ideas of the French Revolution, which just happened in 1790s, which was based on the ideas of human dignity, freedom, and individual freedom of the will. So, but Goethe, unlike Beethoven, wasn't about to give up his social standing for the sake of his ideology. So they were walking together, and then before them came a group of royals, noblemen. And Beethoven held Goethe's hand tightly and said, "My friend, don't let go of my hand. We will walk right through them and show them who we are." But then Goethe, being Goethe, whipped his hand out from Beethoven's grasp, took off his cap and bowed deeply to the nobles. And then Beethoven tipped his hat and barged right through the entire crowd. What's funny is the crowd actually made way for Beethoven and bowed for him. So then after he finished walking through the entire crowd, he looked back at Goethe still. And then after they caught up, he said to Goethe that I waited for you because I admire and respect you, but you, my friend, give your respect and admiration to those who don't deserve it too cheaply. So with an attitude like that, yeah, he's a very special man in history. But that's, I think, the side of Beethoven that we know quite well. I think that the concerto that I'll play today has a side of Beethoven that perhaps not everyone is familiar with. The more human, the more vulnerable side of this man. So by 1804, this concerto was written between the years 1800 to 1804. We cannot confirm again. By 1802, his hearing has degraded so bad that his doctor told him to go to the city of Heiligenstadt to rest. So he went, and there he wrote a testament, a three-page long document dedicated to his brothers, in which he expressed his concerns and how hurt he was that he couldn't hear. He said that he was very taken aback when people think that he is malicious and malignant and not a nice man because he doesn't talk with people. But he says it's only because he can't bring himself to admit to his friends and family that he's deaf, because he's a musician and musicians are supposed to have the best hearing. So being very depressed, he wrote a further entry in the testament and said that he would commit suicide 3 days later. Luckily for us, he didn't. And he said later on in his own words that he was to live on for the sake of his music and for the sake of his art. So by actually being close to death and coming back from it, he had a renewed passion for his work. And this passion and defiance, I think, is one of the most prevalent themes in the works that he made during this era, which not only we have this third concerto, but we also have the Waldstein sonata, which was performed in the last round of performances. And there's also the third symphony, the Ivorka symphony. So I think that this power and this passion, this defiance, we can also see in the first phrase of the piano exposition. But then it's beaten back directly by perhaps it's the sorrow of loss, the pain that comes with his condition. Is very different. It's in a major key. It's very singing and very, very bright. It reminds me somewhat of perhaps an utopian world that he's describing, because after all, in his testament, he did add later on that he was looking forward, he was very much longing for that one day, just one day of pure happiness that he never got. Severe illness, there's always the agony of uncertainty, of waiting to see what happens. He also wrote in this document that he was not sure whether his condition will get better and it's just chronic, or that it would be a lifelong degenerative thing. Unfortunately, it ended up being the latter, being a lifelong degenerative thing, and it made him completely deaf shortly afterwards. But this anxiety and this uncertainty of waiting is, in my opinion, a main part of the development section, for we can hear for one example here. Later on, near the end of this section, with so this type of uncertainty and questioning is a main part of this piece as well. So I think these are the major themes he puts in to the first movement, and he puts them all together, he mashes it all up into the cadenza, which makes it a really great emotional roller coaster, which we will here when we play the whole thing together. The second and third movement, I won't play for you today, but I'd like to say a few words about them anyway. The second movement has a very special kind of texture. All the sounds are in the top upper register, so it's sort of a misty, dreamy atmosphere, and it leads me to believe that perhaps it's his recollection or memory of what a life he once had was like. So this links back to the first piece I played today, the Medtner. We can hear a bit of this texture here. It's a great movement for the one and three, because they're so strong and intense. The third movement is a very joyous and victorious ending to this very passionate work. It's very different from the first movement, and although it's in minor key, it's not, to my understanding, it's not sad. It's powerful and it's strong. Perhaps it marks the beginning of a type of Beethoven's characteristic in which he ends these very big conflicting works with a liberating and joyous last movement. For example, the Opus 110 Sonata in the end is following the massive tragedy. It's a completely, like, almost divine liberation. We can hear a bit of this type of power here. And then the orchestra takes it and then pushes it up. So today I'll only play the first movement. I like to play the second and the third, but so yeah, please welcome my orchestra representative, Miss Stefanie Jacob.